before we go to our devotional time, let's just commit this time to the Lord. At buksan muna natin sa Matthew 17. Okay, let me just read the passage, starting with verse 1. Matthew 17, starting with verse 1. After 6 days, Jesus took with him Peter, James, and John, the brother of James, and led them up a high mountain by themselves. There he was transfigured before them. His face shone like the sun, and his clothes became as white as the light. Just then, there appeared before them Moses and Elijah talking with Jesus. Peter said to Jesus, "Lord, it is good for us to be here. If you wish, I will put up 3 shelters, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." While he was still speaking, a bright cloud enveloped them, and a voice from the cloud said, "This is my son, whom I love. With him I am well pleased. Listen to him." When the disciples heard this, they fell face down to the ground, terrified. But Jesus came and touched them. "Get up," he said. "Don't be afraid." When they looked up, they saw no one except Jesus. Now, alam natin itong account na ito. This has to do with the transfiguration. Just to set our hearts this morning and for the rest of the camp, let me point out 3 things sa passage na ito. One is yung vision that the disciples had of Jesus. No, na transfigure nila before them yung person ni Christ in his full glory. Sana one of our prayers sa conference na to is that we will have a renewed vision of who Jesus Christ really is. Dito nakita ng mga disciples siya in the fullness of his glory. Second, sabi riyan ng magsalita ang God the Father, no, "This is my son," and then it says, "Listen to him." Sana sa conference na to, we'll be tuning so that we may hear his voice. A renewed vision of Christ and a readiness to listen to His voice. Meron tayong sense na, "Lord, speak to me," or "What are you telling me in this conference?" And then yung response natin is we renew our commitment or make a vow to the Lord. Renewing our commitment to His Lordship and to the calling to which He has called us. So a renewed vision, a readiness to listen, and then renewing our commitment to Him. Sana yun ang maging attitude natin as we carry on sa conference natin today and then tomorrow. Okay, Pastor Nathan will bring to us the Word of God.
Did you sleep well? Did you wake up in the right side of the bed? Did anybody woke up on the left side of the bed? Many of our expectations do not happen because we don't control everything. But the things we control are things that we enjoy, as long as it fits our temper. Pastors are basically very temperamental, whether they admit it or not, especially those who are very intentional in the mission that the Lord has given them. Kung kailan nagmamature, nagiging batang pabebe. Ang hirap ng assignment na binigay ng Kuya Philip sa akin kasi when you have focused your mind on something that you like and you would enjoy, okay, I take it. Dalawang devotionals lang ang gagawin natin sa conference na ito. Ngayon at bukas. Wala nang kahapon. So when we had our first devotional in Tagaytay last May, just very few days before, alam nyo yung inihanda mo ng maraming weeks, yung pinag-isipan mo, idinalangin mo, nag-meditate ka, and smooth na smooth, at naka-prepare ka na ng PowerPoint presentation, etc. Sasabihin, pwede bang magpalit kayo? Now, I'm an impromptu speaker. That's one of the strengths that I was able to develop. But pagdating ho sa devotional sa mga pastor, takot akong magluto ng instant noodles. Hindi pa ako mahilig sa lutong Macau kahit na ang lolo ko ay Chinese. Mahalaga po ng pagkain espiritual ay kagaya ng maingat ni Anda, maingat na sinukat, tama sa timpla, and hindi lamang yung timplada ng tatanggap, pati nung tatanggapin nila na Panginoon. Now, of course, we receive Jesus only once as Savior, but we receive Him many times in our many commitments. And one of the most important commitments that we really should be able to understand are the covenants. Sino sa atin dito ang nakipag-covenant kay Lord? Ilan na sa mga covenants na yan ang gusto nyong baguhin? You know, the Lord doesn't want to play like a child na okay na pagkatapos biglang papalitan. When God planned and prepared a covenant for us, it was before the foundation of the world. And He's just waiting for us to mature. One of the beautiful covenants in the Bible was God's covenant with Abraham, right? He called Abraham when he was about 75 years old. Promises, promises, promises. Pagkatapos yung promises, unti-unting nadadagdagan ng responsibilities. Nung una, hindi man naintindihan ni Abraham, doon pa lang sa unang pangako sa Genesis 12, nandun na yung responsibility. I will bless you. Pero, yung I will make you a blessing, eh, hindi naintindihan ni Abraham yun, na commitment pala yun, it's a responsibility. Now, every one of us would like to be blessed. But there's only one principle that God would like us to understand in blessing. We can only be blessed if we are willing to be a channel of blessing. Anything we receive should never be kept. Whatever you hoard will be lost. The only things that remain are the things you give away. Noong nag-devotional po kami sa Tagaytay, I have to struggle. I have lost about 50,000 hairs. Kasi, in 2 days, the 48 hours until I delivered the devotional was a struggle to really be sure that this is the Lord's message. Ganito po yan ang rule na tinuro sa amin ni Kuya Philip. When you deliver a message, is it a good message? Or is it God's message? It doesn't matter if it is a very good message or sometimes not a very palatable message as long as it is God's message. Pero tayo mga pastor, responsibilidad pa rin natin na kahit na mapait, pinapasarap. Mga kapatid, we talked about a very important subject at the time. No, ngayon po, yan pong maging subject natin. May iba ng bagya. It's entitled The Parable of the Great Banquet. Mamaya, kita natin yan na kapag ikaw pala yung nakikain, blessed ka kasi kakain ka, mabubusog ka. Before you eat, while you're eating, and after you have eaten, may accountability pala tayo. Of course, we would be using that version in Luke 14. Meron din po yan sa Matthew 22. But I would like us to take note. Sa Tagaytay, we talked about the gathering in Shiloh. Coming together ang general title niya, and we discussed a very difficult subject na pati yung mga commentators sa Bible had a difficulty of coming together with a common mind. Ano ba ang Shiloh? Maraming nag-appreciate sa mga nakinig. Hindi ko maintindihan bakit lang na-appreciate. Sapagkat ang Shiloh, bagamat isang salitang very evasive ang kanyang tunay na meaning, some would insist, isa yan sa mga pangalan ni Jesus Christ sa Old Testament. Totoo ba yun? But the intention there is the issue about gathering together, what for, wherefore, and the intention of God in gathering His people in the Old Testament. Ang Genesis chapter 49 is the passage that blessed His sons. And that verse, 8 to 12, that portion there is about Jacob's blessing for Judah. But to take note, ang hirap i-reconcile afterwards, ano? Judah ang naging heir apparent. Hindi siya yung panganay, but basically ang mga heirs ay yung panganay. Si Reuben na disqualify, next in line si Simeon, si Levi na disqualify. Now the next eldest son should be Joseph, kaya lang ibang mother siya, hindi siya sa first wife. But Judah received the blessing of the scepter. Rulership, headship. That's why the lineage of the king, of the royal man in Israel, is a Judean, David. So God has to make another covenant with David afterwards. Anyway, pagdating po diyan sa gathering of Jacob's sons, at saka yung gathering point nila is Shiloh, wow, ang bigat pala nun. In the book of Judges, the center of worship in Israel was in Shiloh. The tabernacle was there. Pero merong sinabi si Jacob dito, until you come again to Shiloh. But we never have a Shiloh again. Kasi Shiloh is in the territory of Ephraim, and during the time of Samuel, nung inampun siya ni Eli, the priest, alam natin yung nangyari, ano? The two sons of Eli were killed. And yung grandson ni Eli was named Ichabod, meaning nawala ang glory. The Ark of the Covenant was captured, and Shiloh was burned to the ground. Hindi na ikwento yun sa Bible. But according to the history of the Israelites, Shiloh was burned to the ground. So when Samuel was taking over the role of Eli, as high priest, kasi inampun siya, although he's not a Levite, but he's an adopted Levite by virtue of being adopted by the high priest. And he's also the prophet and judge of the time. Samuel didn't meet the people in Shiloh anymore. But he anointed two kings. Alam natin yun. He met them in his place. Now, you can study that in commentaries and you will enjoy that. Sa Cagayan de Oro, we had another devotional. It's still about gathering together, pero hindi ho ako masaya doon sa unang deliver. I cannot deliver that to the Visayans of Mindanao. Kasi iba mag-isip ang mga taga Mindanao. Shiloh. Shiloh nemo. So, I asked the Lord, give me a reasonable subject that's still about gathering together. And the Lord gave us Matthew 11, 25 to 30. And this is when Jesus sent away the disciples. Sent away. Wala yung 12. Wala yung 70. And who were there? These were the third level of disciples. It is where many evangelists would quote the verse, come now, come to me, all you who labor and are heavy laden. Pero yung coming together by the invitation of Jesus for rest, for learning, it's a call for discipleship. We are gathered to become better disciples or better disciples. So between June and September, Lord, masarap i-deliver yung pangalawa. But it would be unfair if I would deliver a recooked bagong recook bago pero dati pala bagong daan. So Lord, could you give us a beautiful message in Boracay? And as I asked the Lord and as I meditated on God's word, ito po ang ipinagkatiwala ni Lord. Sa Luke 14, 15 to 27, is one of the most difficult parables of Jesus. Now, tandaan po natin, when Jesus introduces a parable, he always starts with, and the kingdom of God is likened unto. Pero hindi po ito na-introduce in that basic manner. We have a similar story in Matthew 22, 1 to 14. And here, we would immediately see, okay, gathering, so it's a gathering in a banquet. Let's see what we can learn from here. Mga kapatid, I would like us to focus our attention on this question. Why do we need to be gathered together? Let's pray. Father, please prepare our hearts, remove our encumbrances, capture our attention, and cause us to listen. Listen to you and learn. In Jesus' name, amen. Why do we gather? Political rallies. Malapit na naman pong eleksyon. Mahilig po ang mga politiko na magtawag, magbigay ng mga libre. Or para mayroong attractive na pupunta ron. Iyayain nila si Marimar para magpakita ng kanyang swimsuit. They would gather. But the intention of the politician is to declare whatever he wants that he is not really telling the people. A politician wants an office for covetous purposes. Wala po ako nakikilalang politiko who would run for an office at yung kanyang sinasabi, yun talaga yung kanyang intention. He would talk about the interests of the people gathered and he would not really tell what his intentions are. What he wants is they would agree that they would vote him and win. And then when he's in office, nakalimutan na niya yung kanyang dating nakausap. So there's a gathering. Iba-iba yung mga intention. Yung mga hindi nag-iisip, sa Tagalog, ang salita lang, mga naguyo. Kaya lagi na lang, panalo na naman. Pero back to zero na naman ang ekonomiya at ang pagunlad ng bayan. Now, other gatherings are for social purposes. Celebrations, birthdays, anniversaries, memorials, reunions, etc. Di ba? Ang sarap mag-reunion, lalo na kung 50 years na kayong hindi nagkikita. Ewan ko kung naranasan na ni Kuya Philip magkipag-reunion sa kanyang kasabay na nag-graduate ng high school. Ano kaya ang kanilang pag-uusapan? Ano kaya yung... And many times, kung si Pastor Ruling tatanungin nyo, ang kanilang pag-uusapan dyan, yung mga nakaraan. Those were the days during our time, which is actually a statement indicating where you are right now in history. Meetings, business, management concerns, policy making. So people gather for that. Lalo na kapag ito ay mga business organizations. Mataas ang kalamang intensyon. Nandyan yung pera, nandyan yung kayamanan. Pero, is that all? Now, there is one more that I would like us to give emphasis on. Spiritual objectives. Jesus calls his disciples. Jesus teaches, instructs his disciples. Jesus commissions his apostles. The apostles passes on Christ's instructions, teachings, etc. These are gathering. We call it religious, and what I'm talking there is about the in the context only of the Christian church. Our major concern, brothers and sisters, ay ang spiritual objectives. We gather for spiritual objectives. Of course, if we open our Bibles to Acts chapter 2, 40 to 47, we would notice there when the new Christians, the new Jerusalem church was gathered, the apostles taught them. There was a gathering for information, for education, for unlearning, and for relearning. When Barnabas went to Antioch, or rather, he went to Caesarea looking for Saul of Tarsus. He went there and brought Saul along so that Saul could be harnessed and become a servant. Sometimes the gathering is not by big groups. Sometimes the gathering is just an invitation of one-on-one. When Elijah gathered those that will come after him, two special guys. The first one was Elisha, who asked for double portion of God's Spirit in Elijah. And the other one was Jehu. Remember Jehu? Elijah and Jehu worked together. They worked together, but not in a consensual way. They worked just to fulfill God's purposes sa kanya-kanyang teritoryo, kanya-kanyang gawaing ipinagkatiwala ng Diyos. Kay Elisha, alam na natin, trabahong propeta. Kay Jehu, trabahong hari. Trabahong bingador. Because God promised that He has to judge the family of Ahab. The family of Omri should be judged. And Isaiah explained that later on. Sabi niya, God created the wicked to punish the wicked. So, si Jehu was the punisher. Elisha was not only the intercessor, he was also the one who confirms. Kailangan lang. Bah, yung spiritual pala, tsaka yung politiko, basically, kahit na wicked politician, could agree on one thing? When their minds and their intentions gather in the forum of God, things happen. And history will record that to testify that only God's intentions will happen when He calls people to be gathered. Jesus calls His disciples. Jesus teaches, instructs His disciples. Jesus commissions His apostles. The apostles passes on Christ's instructions and teachings. Mga kapatid, sa mga pangyayaring ito sa buhay ni Jesus Christ, madalas, makita natin yung introduction, and He called His disciples together and He taught them. And He called them and told them a parable. The gathering of God's people, dapat maging malinaw ito sa atin, mga pastor. Because every Sunday, we're expecting God's people to be gathered. Anong trabaho mo, pastor, when God's people are gathered? Para patawanin sila? Para maging kingkoy at entertainer ka doon sa platform. Mga kapatid, there's one terrible sin that many pastors are doing in their ministry today. Kahapon, tinanong ako ni Pastor Jung if we are going to stand doon po sa taas and we will use a pulpit. It's good to have a pulpit. Bakit? Meron ka paglagyan, may pagpatungan ka. But if we would understand the symbol of the pulpit, this is the symbol of the cross. And pastors unwittingly pray, Lord, hide your cross. Para magtago. Para kapag binanatan niya yung kongregasyon, mayroon siyang kalasag. Meron siyang pagtataguan. But many a time, a pastor would castigate the people of the church, lalo yung mga personal ang kanyang galit sa kanila, and just using the pulpit as an alibi na hindi niyo ko pwedeng salingin. I'm hiding behind the cross. Pastor, are we playing Judas? Are we gathering God's people to savor the banquet of Sunday to Sunday feast? The agape feast of God's word. Remember, yung parable po. talks about sa huling bahagi, a man who is in the banquet who was not wearing proper wedding clothes. What should we wear before we come before a holy God? Anong sinabi ng Hebrews chapter 12? Without holiness, no one can see the Lord. Why do people come to church? Hindi ba? They want to come to see Jesus. Who represents Jesus? Hindi ba yung under-shepherd niya? Could they see Jesus when God's people gather? In you, Pastor. Have you prepared the Jesus Spirit in you when the people come to worship? Mahirap po maging servant. Pero sa ayaw natin at sa gusto, yan po ay tinanggap ninyo. Kaya ang tawag ninyo sa inyong mga sarili, mga ministers. The word ministry means service. Sunday service. Who leads the Sunday service? The Sunday servant. Ganun ba yun? Now, tayo po, we have a permanent status. We are God's servants. If ever we hold a leadership position, that is only a position of accountability. But our status, our rank remains the same. Kaya sabi ni Paul sa Philippians chapter 2, let this mindset be in you. Nano? What's that mindset all about? To think like Jesus. Siya, sa ayaw natin sa gusto, is the King of Kings. He's the Lord of Lords. From the beginning, He is the one worshipped by the angels. When He created anything and everything, the only purpose is so that He will be worshipped and He will be glorified in everything. Maliwanag yan sa Ephesians chapter 1. Paulit-ulit yan at binabanggit ng Efeso kabintulo uno. The purpose of the existence of the church is for His worship. The purpose of God creating anything is for His worship. The purpose why God has identified you even before the foundation of the world is so that you will become a worship leader to the praise and glory of the Creator. Kaya ka nilikha, kaya ka pinili, bago man yan nilikha ang anumang bagay, you were already identified to be a servant, leading people to worship. Pinagpala po kami ng Panginoon sa karapatan na maging lingkod muli sa isang kapulungan na minsan ay gustong wasakin ng diablo. Ngunit binuo ng Panginoon at kami yung kanyang ginamit na mga lingkod, servants. This is now the Malolos. It's now Christian and Missionary Alliance Church of the City of Malolos. Ang dalawang, naging tatlong, naging dating pastor doon, nandito kasama ko. Noong 1997, apat na taon, church planting, nasa classroom kami, nasa bahay ng tren. But the president of the Kamakop asked me to become the district ministry supervisor, parang district superintendent ng buong Central Luzon. Sabi niya, vacate your position and look for somebody to take your place. Hindi ho pwedeng magpastor ang isang district superintendent sa Alliance. So, I chose Pastor Paul. Isa sa mga binigay ng Panginoon sa akin puso na e-mentor. So, nakaranas siya ng torment sa akin at tinanggap pa rin niya at natutorment siya. Sumusunod pa rin. Yeah. Si Pastor Paul. Pastor Paul nga. Pa-Paul-Paul po yan. Apolinario po pangalan niya. masipag. Siya po ngayon na nangangasiwa ng buong Alliance Churches ng buong probinsya ng Bulacan. And also in charge of the four peace of the province. After many years, meron siyang mini-mentor din na tinutulungan. Pero hirap na hirap. Kaya kung saan saan niya nasain para matuto. At muling bumalik sa Malolos. Pinagpala ng Panginoon, nakasama ko rin siya ngayon, si Pastor Olmar. Pastor, saan ka? Ayun, yun. Papansin nyo ninyo, mas matanda siya tingnan sa akin. Pero kapag umiti na siya, mukhang bata siya, mukhang baby na. One year pa lang ho siya halos sa Malolos ngayon dahil bumalik siya. Pero I made a commitment, Pastor, ikaw maging pastor dyan, I will be your assistant. Kaya assistant pastor ako ngayon ni Pastor Olmar sa pastoral ministry sa position sa church. Pero pagdating sa ministry, ako nagme-mentor sa kanya para maging maganda. At pagpalain ng Panginoon, ang church namin, sinusubok namin yung mga aircon. Hindi kaya ng kuryente yung aircon, kaya malalaki. Meron na ang bagong tiles yung church. Materially pinagpala. But we have a program there today. We call it Usher's Class. Every first Sunday and third Sunday, I take charge of the Sunday school. Ang subject namin, ushering. Ang ushering na ito, hindi kagaya ng pagiging waiter sa McDonald's o sa Jollibee na sabihin mo, welcome to, enjoy your meal. Hindi ganun. But we are teaching them that being an usher is ushering anyone who comes into the church to be a worshiper. And to be an usher, you should be a worshiper first. You cannot bring God's people into the presence of God if you are not in the presence of God. Yun ang issue. Kaya, ang pinag-aaralan namin, paano maging tunay na worshiper? Ewa, pinagpala ng Panginoon. Masamang-masamang loob ni Pastor Ron kasi siya yung dating pastor doon, nalipat siya sa isang mas malaking church. Enjoy siya doon ngayon. Pero every first Monday after ng first Sunday ng buwan, basta first Monday after, the Monday after the first Sunday, we gather together for mentoring fellowship. Kainan, kwentuhan, kapihan. What about? We're all learning together. I'm learning a lot from them. Because I could see glaringly my mistakes before and they are doing far better than when I was in their position. Ako'y natutuwa kay Lord. It humbles me that these young pastors are serving the Lord. So when we gather God's people for battle, how do we prepare? How do we prepare for God's banquet? Just a backdrop, a survey of the chapter. Verses 1 to 6, controversial talaga si Jesus eh. The Jews don't do anything on Sabbath day. Bawal magkiskis ng posporo, bawal maglukot ng banig, bawal maligo, bawal maghilamos. No work on Sabbath day, yun ang utos nila. And they made regulations so that anyone who does anything against their prescriptions, when they violate the Sabbath, they can even prescribe death as a punishment for that violator. Ganyan katindi ang ginagawa ng mga Hudyo. But Jesus did something controversial. He healed a man with a dropsy or parang anong katumbas ng dropsy ngayon? Epilepsy? Or basta a kind of a deterioration in the health? On that day, Sabbath day. Now, Sabbath begins on Friday sunset and ends on Saturday sunset next day. So during that Sabbath, Sabado, Jesus did something that the Jews would hate. He healed somebody on that Sabbath day. He did this many times. And on that occasion, they were challenging his authority. And he challenged them about his authority. In verses 7 to 11, kinagabihan, din ay Sabbath, first day na yon. Because the day to the Jews begins at sunset. Inimbitahan sila sa isang banquet o isang kainan. Salo-salo, hindi naman malaking banquet. At yung nag-invite sa kanya, interesting yung discussion. Jesus is a very good talker, conversationalist. And he opened a conversation about how to behave when you're invited. Of course, Jesus was already enjoying the title of a rabbi. At isang rabbi, ibig sabihin niya ni big man ito, parang chief, parang dato, professor, sir. And he taught a very basic lesson on humility. When you're invited to a party, don't get to the presidential table. Try using the least of the tables so that when the person in charge or the host sees you, that's not your place. He would invite you to a more honorable seat, maybe in the head, just beside the host. Then you will be honored. Don't grab the opportunity kasi ganito yung naging ugali ng mga Pharisees and yung audience niya. So Jesus taught them an issue on humility, which is actually an intentional thing that you have to always do. Avoid bragging, avoid grabbing positions, avoid taking the best places. And Jesus provoked a conversation with that comment. Dahil doon po sa verse 13, nadagdagan pa. Kausap na ni Jesus yung host uli. Sabi niya, alam mo, kung mag-invite ka, huwag kang mag-invite ng mga imbitahin ka uli kasi baliwala na yung pag-invite mo sa kanila. When you want to feed people, feed the people who cannot invite you. Hindi nila matutumbasan yung ibinigay mo sa kanila. Bakit? Eh kung natumbasan nila yon, wala na. Patas lang kayo. But if you feed the people who cannot buy food, you feed the people who has nothing to eat, and you feed them sumptuously, food fit for kings, it's not only that they cannot forget you, but you have placed yourself in their hearts as somebody who is really very benevolent. That's a basic principle of charity. At mayroon nag-comment, sabi niya, yung sarap palang kumain sa kaharian ng Diyos, sir. Now, that provoked another story from Jesus. At ito na yun. Verse 15 to 24, binuksan ni Jesus ang kwento ng parable of the banquet. Sa Matthew, ang presentation dito is, a king has opened a banquet. It's about a wedding banquet. Pero yung story is almost the same. I believe that it was the same story said in another context. But let us study what is in here. Now, of course, no pagkatapos doon, yung verses 25 to 35, it gave Jesus the opportunity to present his claims for true discipleship. You can review that. You can take that home and study that. Ah, ito pala yung mga rules of discipleship. If you won't take your cross, you cannot be my disciple. If you love wife, sister, brother, mother, father, brothers, and even your own, if you love them more than me, you cannot be my disciple. Mga ganun mga klase. And he also talked about, before you make this decision to become a follower of Jesus, kwenta muna. If you cannot do it, don't grab the opportunity na nangangahas ka. Like when you answered God's call to become a pastor, hindi mo naman pala kaya. It's not talking about magkano yung aking pundo, magkano yung aking support. Because God's economy is different from how we think we should be supported. I could remember when the Lord assigned us to do church planting in Antipolo City. Bagong labas po ako noon sa seminaryo. I asked the DS, sir, how is this ministry supported? Bit ko aking maleta. Sabi niya sa akin, just trust the Lord. I trusted the Lord. but those were shaky times. Those were radical trimming and training times. But God taught us faith. The real meaning of faith. Na yung wala ka nang isasaing for next meal, and all you can do is lay your hands on your rice box and ask the Lord and thank God that it will be filled before it's cooking time again. That never failed. I'm not more than 40 years in the ministry. Don't ask my age. I have already my citizen's card. Mga kapatid, napakahalaga po nating matutunan ito. Napakahalaga po nating matutunan ito. How can you teach faith, which is the special garb for all God's saints? How can you teach trusting the Lord if you have been through those trying times when you have no other hope but God's personal intervention? May mga kwento na sinasabi sa akin ng ibang mga pastor, Pastor, talaga, buti ka pa, pagkatapos yung mag-pray, may dumating. Sa akin, nag-pray ako na may makain sana kami, wala talagang dumating. Napapahiya po ako. Am I God's favorite? Remember, every blessing has an accountability. If God has blessed you, kaya kung minsan, natuto ako nung ako yung district superintendent, pag pumunta ako sa bahay ng pastor, titinan ko kung nakatingin yung wife or yung, pupuntahan ko yung kusina at hanapin ko yung lata. Kasi lata ng biskwit. Pagdating doon, pasimple, sisipain ko yan. Pag tumunog, walang laman. Before I go, I'll buy them rice. Yun lang, simpleng gesture. Kaya lang, when I was doing that, they were expecting me every time I visit, I bring rice. Nagkamali ako. I should have brought out the rice box and taught them how to pray. My wife is a living testimony. She learned faith in this manner. Pag wala na kaming isasayang, sabi niya, Art, wala tayong bigas para pananghalian. Gagawin lang namin. Labas namin yung rice box, lay hands on it, and sing the doxology. Literally, it not. Mga kapatid, I'm sharing to you the banquet I was savoring in the presence of God. No meals failed. If ever we don't have food to eat because we did not prepare, or we intentionally did not prepare. There was a time, pagkatapos naming umaten nung DTI ni Kuya Philip, Discipleship Training Institute, alumni po ako niya nung school ni Kuya Philip doon. Alas 6 na ng gabi, gutom, sasakay kami ng bus doon sa Cubao. One time, mayroon pa akong mga punti rito, subukin nga natin kung makabili tayo ng masarap na snack man lang sa McDonald's. Na hindi McDonald's, KFC. Sa kanto ng Aurora Boulevard. Pagdating namin doon, pagtingin namin doon sa presyo, maglalakad kaming pauwi ng San Fernando, Pampanga. Tara sa CR. Kunyari pumasok, maki-CR na lang. Tapos lumabas din uli. Wala kami pumili. Tapos dito tayo. Doon kami doon sa hintayan ng mga jeep kung saan yung nagbibinta ng Goto Lugaw. At least doon, 10 piso, mayroon tigisa na kaming mangkok. Kaibigan ko po yung nagtitinda kasi ilunggugid. Masaya, basta ilunggo ka, usap mo. Kahit anong pinag-uusapan nyo, under the sun, pwede mo. Masadyagid. May paaman pa. So, we enjoy that. But, imagine, no? Pumasok ka sa restaurant, hindi ka makabili kasi kulang yung pera mo. Inoon ang hilig-hilig ko pa man din magdala ng attache case. Kaya noon, after that, hindi na ako nagdadala ng attache case. Kasi nandun yung Bible, nandun yung... Ang ganda kasi noon, decente tingnan. Kaya lang, ang impression pala noon, iba. Pastor, every moment, every gesture, every word we say, everything people see about us, whether they are God's people attending the church we are pastoring, or neighbors, or state, when they will know that you are a servant of God, they are expecting to savor the banquet that you are enjoying in the presence of God. Now the final question. But what kind of garment are you using? This is what I know. Some people may never have a Bible. They may never hold or open a Bible all their lives. And the only Bible they will read is your life or the words they hear from you. That is your garment. See, if they cannot read God's word, if you are wearing your wedding garments wrongly, remember when you accepted the Lord's call to the ministry, you entered into a covenant to prepare the bride of Christ. But how are you preparing the bride of Christ for that great banquet? Father, speak to our hearts. Prepare us for that wedding day. Forgive us for our ignorance, for our indifference. Teach us to be found faithful. In Jesus' name, amen.